Hey, how are you doing?
Yeah.
Put the glasses on. I'm like,
yeah.
It's an empowering thing. It's actually really difficult because. So my primary purpose is I'm an artist. This is an art gallery, and I think it gets lost sometimes who I actually am. And I really appreciate it when people say, "Oh, do you want to be in an art gallery?" And this is one mad art gallery, isn't it? It's like a train station, but there's other art galleries. You know, they this is what they do. This is what artists do. You know, they go into the most ridiculous spaces and set up and do a show. And you get very few people turn up. You know, sometimes it's like 10 or 20 people, even for an open mic, come for a drink. But when it's open, generally, no one turns up. You know, artists aren't that well supported. You know, they're not supported whatsoever. You know, and it's really difficult. I took on this role because I was doing a job which, you know, I've got some children married. So you have to find, like, what Terence McKenna, he says, make your own roadshow. Do you know what I mean? So doing the artist taxi driver was my way, this is my medium. Do you know what I mean? As an artist, you're looking around, you're looking at sand and cement and paint and things to make sculpture. And I found, like, being the artist taxi driver. The other day I was making, someone put me onto this book about the right to be lazy. The right to be lazy. And I started to read it and it was like this Paul Lafarge. And then Bertrand Russell was talking about it. And basically what it is if you think about how many musicians, how many writers, how many novelists, how many artists, actually make work because they're allowed the time to think. Yeah. You know, they're allowed the time to dream about who they want to be. But instead of that, you end up with a system that you turn up and Ian Duncan Smith and the government, or you turn up at a job centre and they send you to work in Asda's or they send you to work in Tesco's. No, even you know, they don't even pay you to do it.
Yeah.
They want to knock it out of you. They don't want you to be creative. They don't want you to be an artist. You know, they don't want you to do be a part of people that think. Do you know what I mean? They don't want to. You think of how many albums were written on the dole? How many novels were written because they were supported? And it's purposeful, you know, it's purposeful. You know, if you look around Glasgow, right, your art college was burning down yesterday. Three artists are in the Turner Prize. You know, you think of the music that comes from Glasgow. You know, everything, this is around the UK, you know. In the world, globally, it's massive. It is massive. Billions and billions and billions of pounds. You know, J.K. Rowling was impoverished. Mm-hmm. You know, she's put so much money back. Someone who actually wants to pay her tax as well, which is extraordinary for. But can you imagine? They cut the arts. You know the funding that goes towards the arts? They cut it. Why would they do that? Think about why would they do that? In half. As soon as they come into an industry that makes money, that makes billions of pounds, they don't want to support it. You've got a million youth unemployed. Don't send them to work in Asda's for free. Give them a fucking guitar. Do you know what I mean? Give them a guitar. Ask them who they want to be. No, I was there, I came up today and yesterday, and today I went to, is it Garnad? It's Royston. What was it used to be? Garndad. Garndad. I was down there today, my God. That was a place, you know, and I turned up and the guy said to me, finally a taxi driver, and where is it? And he said, oh, you're a bit early. And he says, have you brought your Rottweiler around it? And he said, I went in there, and the people in there, that what's his name? Tommy Sheridan was there. He's got a suntan, his wife had a suntan. They were incredible people. You know, I never met anyone like that. Seriously, I've never... And then people were saying, some people said something about his life or something that he was doing. I can't remember what it was, but it was funny. But he was there today, I told you, my primary purpose, I'm an artist, so I'm interested in... I never seen anyone talk like that. Has anyone ever seen him talk?
Yeah.
Oh my God. He was on a stage in this little village hall. You know, if you've ever seen like these people that speak, if you've ever seen the great dictator, Charlie Chaplin's speech, if you ever seen any of that today, but even the ones I watched online, I never see anyone do what he done today. He was going down, he was going up, he was telling things like you never... And the people, it was like a wave. They were going on a wave, it was like 40 minutes. And it was like, oh my... Yes! They were like... It was amazing, do you know what I mean? It was a real sort of like spirit, it was really uplifting. And you had to look around where you was. Do you know what I mean? You really had to look around where you was. You know, some other people were talking about, like, guys started talking and said, yeah, when I was in prison, Tommy said, there was a lot of people, they was talking about different things. And I thought to myself, look at where you are. You know, and you look at all these people wanting to have a better life or wanting to, they kept saying, you're going to look your weirds in the eye. I was like, no, it was incredible when they were saying that, you know, because... Everyone wants to be someone. And the guy was saying, you know, when I saw my dad, and he was an older guy, and he was saying, now I look, they need a chance. They need to be someone. And you think about that. Because you look at it and you think, they got no fucking chance around there. No. Do you know what I mean? They don't seem like they got the same chance.
They die at age 55.
They ain't got the same chance in other places. You know, today I was reading about in Scotland, you know, you have the richest amount of people, landowners, the largest concentration of rich landowners anywhere in the world. You know, sheikhs and lords and barons, they own all your land. You know, when you go north of Glasgow, they own everything, just a couple of hundred people. Every single thing. They're scorching the land for grouse. They've got so many deer so that when the bankers turn up to shoot a deer, there's a massive herd and they can't miss. You know, they take your culture, they take your clothes, they get their own tartan. You know, and it's amazing because they're registering the land as businesses.
Aye, not for long.
They're registering their land as businesses in the fucking Cayman Islands under like strange names. But then you start to think, wow, that's amazing. They don't pay no inheritance tax. They don't pay no capital gains. They don't pay any tax at all. At all. Not only that. They are paid hundreds of millions of pounds in subsidies, like farm subsidies, because they're registered as businesses. Can you imagine that? Multi billionaires and people down in Royston are going to work, paying their tax. To pay for that, they don't even need the subsidies. You know, that is an analogy for the whole of the UK. Do you know what I mean? That is an analogy for the whole of the world. It's fucking feudalism. They don't pay tax. You know, all that, we're all in it together. These people, you know, these billionaire companies, you know, people like fashion, girls like fashion, they like going, boys like going, they like going to buy clothes. They go into Topshop, they go to work, they sweat their guts out, they go into Topshop and they're buying clothes. He takes all his money, Philip Green, he gives it to his wife in Monaco, all of it, pays no tax. And he thinks it's okay, and it's not okay. Not only that, he works for the government. He's taken on as a business advisor. They embrace it, they love it, because they think what they're doing, who's it, have we got those biscuits?
Yeah.
Have we got the biscuits? I ordered some biscuits. I wanted to show you something about what they actually, how business works, how the economy works, how money works. And it works on circles.
Pass me the biscuits.
So basically,
I do some little
they're not interested. They want debt, do you know what I mean? They're not interested in the amount of debt. If you pay £200,000 for a house, they're not interested in the £200,000. It stays in things. They're interested in the debt. They want the war machine, the banks, the oil, the arms. It's the privatisation of NHS, the privatisation of probation, the privatisation of child protection. Can you imagine that? And it's all allowed to happen. Not only is it allowed to happen, it's embraced. It's embraced. Oh, look, we've got lots of biscuits here. So I need, and what do I need? I need some coins. I need, like, 3 coins or 5 coins.
This way.
Yeah. 5 coins.
5 coins.
Alright. So I'm the boss. I'm the boss. I'll tell you at the back what I'm doing. I'm the boss. I don't need all that money. Alright, I'll take it anyway. I'll just keep that. That's just mine.
And the rest. What's your bank in the room?
Okay. So basically, I'm the boss, and you're all the workers, right? Now, how it works, we all contribute to society. This is from the Ragged Trousers of Philanthropists, if you probably know. Yeah. So this is, I'm the boss, you all work for me. And what I want you to do is I want you to make the necessities of life, you know, like we all do, like the big men do, like the house builders, and the people that work on the trains, the people that do cars, teachers, doctors, you all do the necessities of life. So you work for me. I want you to make 3 necessities of life this week. So you got 3. You work for me as well. So give you 3. You work for me. They get 2 there. You work for me as well. There's 3 biscuits there. Piers, you work for me as well. Alright. So that's what you gotta make those, and you make them for me, because I'm the boss. So what you do is it's the end of the week and you've come to me and this is what you've made. So I say, I'm gonna take it all. So I take these biscuits, all these biscuits here, and I give you all 1 coin each. So for that 1 coin, because you can't eat that, that's metal. This is how money entraps you. This is how money keeps people in poverty. Because I've just given you a piece of metal that you can't eat. You've made the necessities of life for me. I own them. I own everything. I own the hospitals, the schools, all of it. The factories, the trains. So you need to live. So I take all this, it's 1 for you, you can have 1, you have 1, you have 1. So take your biscuit, because you need it, that's what you need to live on. So you can eat it. So now, come back next week, because you've got nothing left, you've eaten your biscuit. So you need to work again. I've got the money back, by the way. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
I've got all the money back. So you've gone off and you're working again for me. Are you You've eaten your biscuit. It's finished. There's your pound back. Give me your pound back. There's one biscuit. You see what's happening?
Yeah.
Right, eat your biscuits. All of you, take a biscuit. Take the biscuits. You've earned it. You did well. Come back next week. You've done it again. You're brilliant. You're fantastic. Look at all those things that you've made. There's your coin. Oh, it's my minute. There's your biscuit. Take your biscuits. You did well. Who hasn't taken their biscuit? Take a biscuit, please. You got an extra biscuit this week. Do you know, you're back again. You have to work every week, because every week you need your biscuit, don't you? What are you going to do with your kids? What's going to happen if your kids got no biscuits?
I don't have any kids.
So look, there's all the biscuits. The biscuits, that was the money. Look, so what's happened? I've got all the money, all of it. But look at this. Can you see that? These are all the necessities of life that you made. I own all of this. This is surplus. This is the key. This is the everything to do with economics. The surplus. You know, all the things that everyone, when you wake up every single Monday to Friday, now you have to go Saturday, Sunday, every day that you're working, it's getting bigger and bigger. You know, they've only been at work, it was that 3 or 4 weeks. Look how much they made. Look how many cars they made. Look how many useless things in the pound shop they made. Look, they made loads and loads of stuff. I'm gonna have to let you go. I've got too much stuff. Let you go. You're young, you can stay. You can go, okay, you two can stay. I'm going to have to let you three go, so you're going to have to go and find yourself another job. Yeah, you can form a union, you can do what you want. You know, I'll shut the factory down, I'll move somewhere else, like the guy in Grange Mount said he was going to do. The surplus is the key, because I can now sell this to somebody else over here, over there, and you just keep making things. This week, you know that I've let you keep your job. I can only give you half a biscuit this week, and you two half a biscuit. No, so all of this is what we're all doing. We're all working for biscuits. They've got all the money. They've got all the biscuits. They're getting more biscuits, but it's never enough for them. No, it will never be enough for them.
Can I keep them?
You know, because they're so greedy, they don't understand, they can't stop. It's like the guys in the banks, the hedge funders, they can't stop. The whole thing is built, they just can't stop buying things. You know, the idea of capital, like Amazon, they don't even No, they got so much money. Philip Green, they got so much money. They're only interested. They don't even want the money. They just want to like reinvest it. They want to make more. They want to make more and more. You know, they don't want to pay tax and they just get more. But while these people, like this three here, they work. They ain't got no work. She's on half a biscuit. She's on half a biscuit. No, and I've still got all of this. They're out their house. We're going to close the centre. Actually, you know, we don't need the hospital. We're in this whole permanent austerity is around our needs. That everyone is still working. You know, they've still got the same amount of unemployed today as they had 10 years ago, as they had 20 years ago, as they had 30 years ago. Look it up. You know, the same amount of unemployed, it stays. You know, they just get fat. And they just get fatter and fatter and fatter. And they can't stop.
Where we are starved.
If you think all of those people that are up shooting grouse and you know, they're not even there. You know, it's not even, you know, it's just another castle to them. You know, they're rich oil sheikhs and they're lords and everyone's too scared, you know, in politics, because all the politicians, you know, the fact is, every single politician, every single one, no matter who they are, is corruptible. You know, because we all are. You know, you can't trust, like, a single person. It's undemocratic to put everything into a single person. You know, these people are 600 MPs. You know, Scotland has never, ever voted for a Tory government. No, you don't get the governments that you vote for. You know, the people in Scotland, even Tommy Sheridan was saying today, they want their public services. We want our hospitals. We want our schools. You know, everyone, it's a good thing to think about community. It's a good thing to think about society. But as soon as you bring in things like party politics, it's corruption. It's corruption. You know, you need to take your independence. You need to 2 years later change your political system. But it's Scotland needs to lead the way. He was saying today, we're not leaving England behind. You know, we want to lead everywhere. We want to tell people around the world. You know, we have a chance and opportunity to have a different, like, I don't know, society or at least try to have it, where every 4 years you have a referendum where you can write down what you want to do in the 4 years with your hospitals, what you want to do with your schools, and agree on it. You know, there is no way that you can turn up with a private corporation to make money from child protection, from probation, from the NHS. It's outrageous. There is no way of making a profit. They are not a market. It cannot be a physical market. It's impossible. The only thing you can do is cut the services, cut the wages. There's a finite of money. And that's what they keep telling you about. Your deficit. You know, they want to tell you that you've got to cut this, you've got to cut that. Nothing's changing. They're just taking it all. You know, the media, tomorrow I'm going to go to that CCA, the Centre for Contemporary Arts, and they're talking about the media. It's a talk on the media and independence. You know, people said to me, Tommy Sheridan's not on the telly. I don't have him on the telly. You know, the people, you know, they control the roadshow. That's their roadshow. That's why you have to make your own roadshow. Do you know what I mean? You have to make your own roadshow. It's the only way. That is a weapon. That is their ultimate weapon. That is their bazooka. You know, yesterday in England, UKIP didn't win a council. You'd have thought they cleaned up there 100%. You would have thought, how was that even possible? It's constructed. Do you know what I mean? It's about subterfuge. It's about, you know, years ago when things happened, and you look at them clearly now, and you look back at history, when you see big struggles, you know, when strikes, you saw that the corporation that you were striking against, you know, they were aligned with the media, they were aligned with the politicians, you know, and they would crush a strike. You know, you can't, you're not working. It's, you know, they are all part together. You know, there is no way a newspaper will run a full page, £40,000 advert for Tesco's or a bank or McDonald's and slag it off on the other page. There's no way they will do that. They buy the newspaper through advertising. They buy the newspaper through sponsorship. It's what happens. You know, the AstraZeneca and Pfizer. Where do you think they get all their ideas from? They go to the university that everyone pays for. Do you know, they go to the university, they steal the ideas because they buy a wing in the university. Do you know what I mean? They're funding. It's peanuts to them. No, they do it with the arts as well. We have BP sponsoring. We have Israeli arms dealers sponsoring things. You know, they just buy it, and it's cheap. But I, in the end, I don't know what that's. Well, I don't know about that bit. I don't know what else to do. Do you know what I mean? So it's like the making of the art is all that. That's the only thing that that drives me. Do you know what I mean? I like making art. You know, honest to God, it is such a privilege to be an artist. No, it really is. Another Terence McKenna, he said, culture is not your friend. Culture is not your friend. But we are led by the least amongst us. We are led by the least noble, the least intelligent, the least visionary. And then someone in the audience says, how do we fight back? And he said, make art. You know, they are powerless against human passion. They are powerless against creativity. They are powerless against poetry, against music. That's why they try and corrupt it. That's why they try and they don't want you to make it. Do you get that? They don't want you to make it. Because they think if they kill the artist, they kill the protest. That's why they don't want Occupy. That's why they don't want squatters. Because they know that there's philosophers there, and there's thinkers there, and there's creatives there, and they form a society outside of theirs, and they're going to be talking about politics. And they're scared of that shit. That's why they feed you with the TV is God. That's why they feed that into your brain every single day. That's why we end up making. I don't know about that fellow as well. It's really strange. I found interviewing people quite difficult. It's really hard interviewing people because when I'm in the taxi, I'm screaming. Do you know? If you see me screaming, it's like a bulletproof car. Do you know what I mean? There's people walking down. I don't know, it's a Nissan Primera, but it must have incredible fuck-off glass, because people just walking past, I'm shouting like that. It's like, I don't think they can hear me, or I feel like they don't hear me, or they're just ignoring me, do you know what I mean? But it's like, I feel really safe in there. I feel really safe inside the, you know, that, you know, I'm allowed to speak, aren't I? We're all allowed to have a voice, we're all allowed to say, you know, this is my fucking roadshow. You know, this is my roadshow. This is my TV channel. You know, this is what I'm channeling today. I can tell you, you know, that's it, isn't it? That's why, like, it is a privilege to be an artist. And when you see the people, the activists, and I've met loads, you know, the people from DPAC, do you know them, the disability, they are hardcore. they are brilliant. Do you know, I was interviewing Andy, and he's going down to thingy, he's got no legs and one arm, and he says, I'm going down to the DWP. I said, what are you doing down there? Well, we've got a prison, we're going to put you outside, we're going to get inside and we're going to lock on. Thinking, you know, these are the only people that I've met that are carrying, you know, they're really impassioned about direct action. And, you know, I never endorse anything for anyone. I think everyone has to take their own responsibility about what they want to do, you know. It's not like, but I think they're incredible people, you know. I feel very inspired. I feel very inspired talking to lots of people. Anyway, I think I talked to a lot tonight. thank you very much to Leanne and Patrick, who run this space. It's cool, isn't it? Because my son, he said to me, where is this guy? He said, how do they survive here? You know, how do they make any money? You know, how do they live? Well, it's incredible, no? That. Anyway, okay, hey. I got what? There's biscuits.
I'm on my way to Glasgow. I'm on my way to Glasgow. Glasgow in Scotland. Scotland, the centre of the universe. The centre of the... I have left the Ukipalypse. I've left the Ukipalypse behind. If you got it inside your nuts that you're gonna go and you're gonna start voting on whether you want another country to be in charge of you, when you're gonna vote that another country will create your laws, will steal your land, will get out on a funny and put a kilt on and pretend they're Scottish to go out into their land, shooting to their stolen lands, shooting their grouse, eating their shortbread, thinking they're a barn brack. What? They're tea and they're Scotland. They're German, and they're in the middle of your country because this isn't about. This is about kicking out. This is about kicking out evil, despicable landlords that would see you dead. That would see you without your workers' rights, without your. They would see you without your holiday. They will see you with your children, with snow, with dirty knees. They would see you. They want to privatise child protection. They want balancing. They sold the NHS. You want to let them govern over you? The sea of London, the sea of corruption that is interested in every resource, every land, every profit, every single grain of bloody grass in the world that has been in Scotland for century upon centuries. They don't care about you. They are fat cat bloody bankers. They have £80 billion in bonuses since the financial crisis. They have massive corporations that pay no tax. They have cafe bloody zero tax. If you want, you should vote for independence. Vote for independence, and within 2 years, demand political system bloody reform. Demand that the political system is reformed after 2 years. Set yourself up. Do an Iceland. Get like the Nordic countries. Get into peaceful bloody people. Don't be involved in wars, in militias. Put democracy into the hands of the people. Set up direct democracy. Get party politics. It's the illusion of choice. Party politics is the biggest load of bollocks you'll ever see in your life. The central point of party politics is getting people to vote to create the illusion of a legitimacy. Even Caroline Lucas, who I saw in things, she said you cannot. This is not a democracy. Parliament is not a democracy. It's about corporations. Corporations that can buy an MP like that whenever it likes. Every single one of them bought and sold. Direct democracy. Have referendums. Do a manifesto every 4 years on health, on education, on social security. Listen to the people. People are inherently good. It's only when the mainstream media, it's only when the elite, when the corporate propaganda feeding things inside your nut that tells you to hate. That's what the UKIP-alypse, that's what the UKIP-alypse is about. It's about them keeping control, keeping power. There's one thing you've learned from last night's election and from the election results you're going to see in the EU. There's one thing you learned, Scotland, is you do not let these pigs into your lives. They want to see your children indebted through education. They want student fees. They want to privatise National Health Service. That you should have state servants. You should have people every 4 years, students, philosophers, artists, teachers, doctors, bin men. They should be the ones making the decisions, not these lunatics that want to start wars, that want to steal other countries' resources, not these ones that want to do away with workers' rights, that want to privatise everything that's not nailed down. If you have an NHS that is in a public service, that adds to your economy. You're paying nurses, you're paying doctors. They put that back in. You privatise it. Your bloody money's on the way to the bloody Cayman Islands. It's on its way to the bloody Bahamas. That's why these private profiteers, they have got endless pots of money, like your Amazon, your Google and your Starbucks, to infiltrate the political system, to buy and sell MPs whenever they bloody like. You know, that bloody Patrick Mercer and Fiji. That is what they do. That's their stick. Scotland, I'm coming to Glasgow. I'll be on the streets of bloody Glasgow later tonight. I'll be there tomorrow at the Queen's Park Railway Station. I'm in Scotland. I'm in Glasgow. I'm staying at Frankie Boyle's house. There's Frankie over there now. He's going over there to, look, he's going over there to get a taxi. He's jumping in his taxi. He's off filming. He's not the person you think he is. He's not the person that you think he is. He's a Buddhist. He's centered. He's taking the spectacle and he's vomiting it back at you. That's who he is. Look. Get in here, Frank. I've just been telling. I'm staying at Frankie's house. He's not. He's a Buddhist. He's been meditating in there, chanting. He's centered, taking the spectacle, and vomiting it back at you.
I've got one thing to say, Mark, and that is that the fire at Glasgow School of Art was a magical attack aimed at an independent Scotland by the Illuminati.
I thought he was your mate.
Mate, I've got to go. Take care, mate.
Listen, right, I'm in Scotland, I'm in Glasgow. Talking about free Scotland. Can you imagine you woke up and you... Listen, legally, feudalism ended in 2004. But little has changed. The 15 years of devolution, and you still see the rich world's greatest concentration of ownership is here in the hills in the Latin Scotland. They own Scotland. Who owns it? Nobody. I got this from George Moneybot this morning. No one dares challenge aristocrats, oligarchs, bankers, sheikhs. They own all the land. No one wants to challenge them because of fear of consequences, real or imagined. The bloody police protect them. Look at that Donald bloody Trump. You know, the Scottish government, they say, yeah, we're going to do this about land reform and do this and do that. And they kiss the royal baronial boot. Huge estates, massive estates in Scotland. They go on as far as the eye can see. They're massive, untaxed, unregulated. Try and find out who bloody owns these places. For a couple of hundred people own all the land. You're here in Glasgow, living in your tenements, living in like all cities, like rabbits as close, and they own everything. They own everything, but that's not even the thing. These large estates, they're registered in the companies with made up names in bloody the Cayman Islands, in the Caribbean. Scotland's deer stalking and grouse moors is not agricultural land, but they get the same advantage as farmers. They're exempt from capital gains tax, exempt from inheritance tax, exempt from business rates. Landowners justify their grip on Scotland, in the UK actually, by rebranding themselves as business owners. They get millions upon millions in farm subsidies. You're like, you what? Not only do they not pay tax, they're getting public money. What? You what? You can't make it up. You cannot make it up. You got... The government now, they want to bring in a different payment system where the bloody, the king of Dubai is going to get hundreds of thousands of pounds more for his estate in bloody Rossnair or the Duke of Westminster, another £1 million, another hundred and millions of pounds, Duke of Roxburgh, and all of what they do, what George Moneybot, he said they're burning the bloody hills. It looks like it's been under, Harry's been out, and they've napalmed. It's like, the whole of the hills are burned, scorched. Why? For the bloody grouse. Can you imagine? Most of the hills are grazed to the roots because they're overstocked with deer because a banker wants to wake up, he flies out there and he wants to wake up, he wants to be like the Serengeti, a fucking wildebeest, a fucking deer. So he gets his gun out and after he's had a few toots of fucking Charlie, he can't miss. Do you understand all this? Do you get it? Hanging over this, hanging over the, all these, is Balmoral. Balmoral, George Money, Balmorality. Balmorality, where the clearing and the burning has been overseen by Prince Philip. He said the little's changed since Victoria and Albert was there, and they took the clothes and the customs from the people that they cleared from the bloody lands. Scotland should list all its landowners. Scotland should impose taxes on these on these parasites, on these vultures. They shouldn't be given public money. Money that's supposed to be for your children's education, for your hospitals. What's that going to the kings and the barons? What for their grouse? Do you get that in your net? They don't pay no tax, you pay them. Do you get that? They said they shouldn't be given public money. This is the crux of everything. This is everything. This is it. This is this one metaphor. This one thing. It shows you about the feudalism, about the inequality. Scott, it's all there. It's all there. They're out. Kate's out. She's got another house, another few million pounds of public money. These people don't need your taxes. They don't pay their tax, and you still pay them in subsidies. Grouse shooting deer, and you're paying for it when they go around in their tweed with their bottle of Scotch whiskey and their barn brack and their shortbread. Do you understand that? You got that. Scotland, if you've got any sense, you will vote, you will take your independence, you will clear your land of these power, of these carrion feeders. You will not, how could you even, this is Britain, this is the UK though. Everyone in the UK has to understand this. And what they do is they give you this UKIP-a-lops, and they make you hate and fear while you're down in squabbling, bickering. They're out doing whatever they like. You're paying for it. I'm the United States driver. This, my friends, is Tommy Sheridan. I've just been in there. I've just been listening to him doing a meeting wearing
Garengad.
Garengad, not
in
Royston.
Royston. Garengad and Royston.
Absolutely. Tommy Sheridan, the most prominent voice for independence for Scotland. There's a vote on September the 18th. Why should people vote for independence, Tommy?
Freedom. Freedom, it's as simple as that. Free to choose our own government, free to get rid of nuclear weapons, free to introduce a living wage instead of a poverty minimum wage, free to decide that our public services should stay in the public sector, free to decide that the NHS should stay public, free for our kids to be brought up and not have tuition fees and to have smaller class sizes, free to decide our own destiny. Freedom, that's what it's all about.
Because, I mean, one of the things you said in there, that you've had 30 years of Tory governments and you've never voted for one of them.
That's the point. Not since 1951. That was the last time the Tories ever won a majority of the votes in Scotland. Every single Tory government since 1951 has been a government that's rejected by Scotland but has been foisted upon us because of the votes in England. And the other way to look at it is there has never been a Labour government elected that relied on the Scottish vote. So it's not as if England's been abandoned by us. If England wants to vote Labour, they'll vote Labour without the support of the Scottish votes. So what we're saying is, basic democracy is you get the government you vote for. And that's what independence means.
Because you said as well, interestingly, you said something about you're not abandoning the working people of England.
Not at all. I've got lots of friends and comrades in England and Wales. I've got loads of respect for English Labour movement history. You know, your Tall Puddle Martyrs, your trade union movement, your Tony Benn, your Bob Crowes. Personal friends of mine. It was gutted when they died. It's been a loss to the movement. But what we're going to do here in Scotland is we're going to introduce a new way of looking at things. We're going to reject neoliberal economics. We're going to reject the nuclear weapons. We're going to start putting people before cash. We're going to say that we want public services that deliver for people. And that is going to give encouragement to people in England and Wales. That's going to let people in England and Wales know, hey, wait a wee minute, if the jocks can do it, so can we.
So you're dragging the English people with you. That's what you're saying.
Well, I'll tell you what. I wouldn't say dragging. I would say leading. And I've got to say there is a wee bit of precedent to it. Because the anti-poll tax campaign, let's remember, we got it a year first before you guys. We built mass non-payment, and then I was an export from Scotland down to England, went to meetings all over England. We built the All Britain Anti-Poll Tax Federation, and we beat Thatcher. We melted the Iron Lady and sent her after the political knacker's yard where she belonged, and we showed quite clearly if working class people stick together, we can beat something. What we're doing here is we're realising our independence, realising our destiny, and we're going to show people in England and Wales, hey, if we can reject these people, these multi-millionaire toffs, then so can you.
Do you know, you didn't mention it in there, but it was something I was reading this morning, that the rich world's greatest concentration of land ownership is in Scotland. True. And no one dares, this is George Money, he said, no one dares challenge aristocrats, oligarchs, bankers, sheikhs. Who owns this nation? Who owns Scotland?
The land is owned by a very, very tiny number of multi-billionaire landlords, most of them absent landlords. There was a report come out just yesterday which is calling for the whole of Scotland, constitutional Scotland, to take on land reform, to get rid of the idea that these landed gentry will own land and then just hold it. It's non-productive, it's not doing anything. Meanwhile, we need land for houses, we need land for arable production. We, as a small country, have an opportunity to say, hey, wait a minute, land belongs to people. Doesn't it belong to individuals? There's certainly no for rich individuals, but don't even live in the country.
Extraordinarily, I read, that they're registering this land, great sway, grouse and deer and shooting bank. They've registered as businesses. They pay no capital gains. They pay no tax whatsoever. On top of that, they get farm subsidies. They're not even... And they get public money. Listen, hundreds and hundreds of millions of pounds.
It is shocking. It is shocking. If you look at the figures, when they talk about benefit scroungers... The benefit scroungers isn't it your lone parent struggling to make ends meet, or the unemployed that's lost his job because of the economic incompetency of the bosses in this country. The real benefit scroungers are the landlords and the millionaires. They're the real benefit scroungers.
You said in there, the essentials of life are in private pockets.
Well, you think about it. Why is it you guys are even worse than us in England? Because you can't even flush the toilet without you're making money for somebody private pocket, because your water's privatised, for God's sake. It falls for the sky. Why is it privatised? Why is the electricity privatised? Why is gas privatised? Why are the trains and the buses privatised? These are the things we need, for God's sake. Let's get them back where they belong, in public hands, and use them for public need, not private profit.
So what about this white paper that they produced?
The SNP government produced a white paper of the reasons why people should vote for independence. There's some good stuff in there. They're talking about getting rid of nuclear weapons. They're talking about saving the mail service from privatisation. They're talking about introducing a living wage instead of a poverty minimum wage. All of it's great, but it's only the start. It's only the start. What I would say is, here's your wee building block. That's the base. Let's build on that building block, and let's look at public ownership of gas, electricity. Let's look at higher pensions. Let's look at a wage, which means people not only have dignity in their work, but they pay tax. And if they pay tax, we've got more revenue. And if people have got a decent wage, they buy goods and services. They buy goods and services, creates demand for those goods and services. So you've got what's called the marginal propensity to consume. Never mentioned it in there, I should have mentioned it. Marginal propensity to consume, a benefit of an economics degree, it makes the world go round. You give an extra fiver to a millionaire, he doesn't spend any of it, he puts it in the bank because he's already satisfied all his needs. Give an extra fiver to somebody on low pay, what do? They spend that £5. What does that do? That creates more demand for goods and services for other people to create jobs. You have got what's called a virtuous cycle, economic cycle. That's what we could do in Scotland.
You were talking about sovereignty in there. What's that mean?
Sovereignty. It's good you make that point, because my wife asked me, one of my meetings recently, I'd been talking about sovereignty. She says, Tommy, you never explained, what was sovereignty? Is that something to do with the Queen? And I said, no, actually, what it is who's got supreme power? Who is the law above all laws? And in terms of the UK constitution, what people maybe don't understand is the Parliament, the UK Parliament, is the supreme ruler. If the Parliament passes a law, there is no one can challenge that law. Parliament could pass a law that you're not allowed to spit in the street in Paris. Now, it's not enforceable, but they could still pass that law. What we're looking for here in Scotland is sovereignty for our Scottish government and our Scottish Parliament, so that when we pass laws, they are the higher laws. They cannot be challenged by anybody else.
Scotland, you were saying in there that you believe Scotland is a left of centre country.
Absolutely. If you look at the electoral results, certainly from 2007 onwards, Labour in Scotland used to weigh the vote. They never counted it because it's a Labour country. That was in the days when Labour used to support unilateral nuclear disarmament, when Labour used to oppose privatisation, when Labour used to stand for workers' rights. Labour now opposes nuclear disarmament. Labour has introduced the private finance initiative. Labour no longer supports trade union rights. The SNP has become the party that has put on the clothes that have been abandoned by the Labour Party. And who's winning the votes in Scotland now? The SNP. The SNP in 2011 done what the Scottish Parliament wasn't supposed to allow to be done. They won a majority in the Parliament. Why? Because they're a left of centre party. We are a left of centre country.
You said the other thing I wanted to let the people know about that thing that you said when you went to the public school.
Yeah, I went to the part. I was invited when I was an MSP. I was invited to Fettes College in Edinburgh. It's one of the most expensive public schools in Scotland. It's the one that Tony Blair went to. There you go. And when I went into the hall, 300 kids there, they all stood up very, very polite. And I put my pitch for an independent socialist Scotland where the land would be publicly owned, the rail would be publicly owned, the gas, electricity, that we would have a better quality and standard life for every man, woman and child in Scotland. They all listened politely. And then when we chat, we James got up and said, Mr. Sheridan, isn't it the case that in this independent Scotland that you talk about, you intend to close Fettes College? And I said, no, sir, you're wrong. On the contrary, in an independent socialist Scotland, we won't close Fettes College. We'll open up Fettes College so that every kid gets the opportunity for a curriculum choice of 22 subjects to learn different languages, smaller class sizes, because I'll tell you what, the rich pay for that, for their wins. Why does every Wayne not have the opportunity for that type of education?
And you, a progressive politics you mentioned in there.
Absolutely. Progressive in the respect that left of centre means that you believe in community values, you believe in public service, you believe that people aren't on their own. You reject the Thatcherite philosophy, that philosophy that she developed when she spoke at the Royal Geographical Dinner in 1991, stood up and said, there is no such thing as society, let us glory in inequality. Well, I don't want to glory in inequality, I want to get rid of inequality.
There was it looked grassroots in there. It looked like it just, some people were saying the first time I'd been in a meeting, you was talking about the meeting you went to last night. But they never published a poll recently. They still haven't. How do you think the vote's going to go?
Well, the UK government commissioned a poll, paid £50,000 for the poll. And the word on the ground is that the poll shows that there has been a significant shift to yes, and it's now neck and neck. Personally, I'm confident we're going to win. We're going to win because there is a subterranean movement that's taking place here. Real grassroots. You saw people in there. They're grassroots. That meeting was called by a guy that's never organised a meeting before. Last night in Newark Hill, organised by a woman. Never organised a meeting before. People are contacting us on Twitter. People are contacting us on Facebook. Going to come and speak in my community centre or my hall. They're not in political parties. They've never done these things before. And people turning up by the hundreds. I've never seen it since the days of the poll tax campaign, another grassroots campaign. We won that one. We're going to win this one.
On the Irish Taxi Drive, this, my friends, has been the incredible Tommy Sheridan.
There we go.
You're pro-independence, right?
Pro-independence, absolutely, yes.
What do you think about people who would like to vote no?
I think people voting no may be doing it because they're frightened. They are worried about change. They're worried about what the future holds. I would say to them, please don't allow fear to dominate your views. Please allow hope to take over the fear. That's why my speaking tour is called Hope Over Fear. I would ask them to think, what is Scotland going to be like in 10 years, 15 years, 20 years? Because if we stay with the UK corrupt Westminster system, we're going to have more cuts, more poverty, more inequality, more privatisation. If we go for an independent Scotland, we can reject that. We can reject nuclear weapons and we can promote people rather than profit.
Do you not think that an independent Scotland, the government could be just as corrupt as the one we have now?
That's up to us. That's up to us, Tiny or PJ, sorry, brother. That's up to us whether we allow any future Scottish government, independent Scotland, to be corrupt or not to do as they're told. Personally, I believe we should have a new political contract in relation to politics in Scotland so that when you're elected and you put your manifesto forward, that's a contractual obligation that can be legally enforced so that you can't just have a manifesto that's about a toilet paper. You say something to get elected and then after you get elected, you do the absolute opposite. I think politicians should be able to be removed under a right of recall in a matter of months rather than wait years. I think politicians, just like nappies, should be changed regularly and for the same reason.
Do you think an independent Scotland would be economically stable?
Economically stable and very, very viable. For the last 32 years in a row, Scotland has produced more tax and revenue than we have got back from Westminster. 32 years in a row. The average tax and revenue generated by from an individual in Scotland is £10,700 compared to £9,000 for England. So we are starting off not as an economic basket case, we're starting off with an economic surplus.
One of the main economies in Scotland is the oil industry. Do you think that could fail or dry up?
Well, we've been told for, I'd say, maybe 40-odd years that the oil's running out. The most recent report has said there's at least as much oil still in the North Sea as has already been extracted from the North Sea. So it's not a case of it's running out tomorrow or next year or 10 years. There's plenty there. Personally, let's not put all our eggs in the one basket. Let's invest via the oil revenues in clean energy, in wind power, solar power. That's the future as far as I'm concerned. Clean energy production. We in Scotland, wind, wave, solar, we could become one of the leading generators of that type of clean energy in the world. That's what we need to invest in.
So do you think Scotland should adapt more green or eco-friendly policies?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Scotland has to look to the development and defence of our environment, of our society as a whole. We can't just rely on oil. Oil in and of itself is not sustainable environmentally. We have to look at alternative forms of energy production. But if we have public ownership of those industries, and if we invest properly, so it's not just for private profit, but for public good, then we can develop those technologies a lot quicker.
Would you support Scotland joining the EU?
Well, personally, I've got to say that's for a referendum in the future. Me, I believe in sovereignty for Scotland. I believe Scotland should decide its own policies, its own destinies. The European Union right now is our boss's corrupt club. The European Union is for the promotion of capitalism, for the promotion of privatisation. I don't want to be a member of that club. We're up to Scotland to decide that democratically.
I know you think that the yes vote will win, but if the no vote does win, what will you do next?
Well, if the no vote wins, I'll probably cry a lot. I'll be very, very sad, because I believe it will mean more cuts, more austerity, more punishing of the poor for the mistakes of the rich, because that's what austerity is, isn't it? You know, there's no pensioners, there's no people in benefits, there's no immigrants, there's no asylum seekers who caused the economic mess we're in. But yet they're to blame for the economic mess. They've been punished for that economic mess. Instead of punishing the people who are responsible, the bankers and the millionaires and the politicians who let them walk all over them, they're the ones responsible for the economic austerity. If we vote no in September 18th, there's going to be more of that. I'm going to be very, very sad. I'll dust myself down, however, and I'll get back into the fight, but it'll be harder.
If Scotland becomes independent, what party would you like to gain power, or would you like to change the political system as a whole?
I think the political system is going to be in absolute flux. I think there's going to be new alignments, new political parties. I think Scotland is going to be opening up to new ideas and new formations. I don't think it will stay the same. I think there will be a left of centre political party with trade union backing, with socialist roots. That's the type of party I'm
hoping. Would there be any party that you would favour?
Right now, it'd be very, very difficult because the big parties, I mean, the Labour Party as it is just now, isn't worth supporting because it's abandoned its principles. The SNP is a left of centre party, but at its core, it's a big business party. The Greens and Solidarity, my own party, well, we're small potatoes as far as the big issues are concerned. I think there will be realignment, and I think some of the smaller parties will become part of bigger movements.
So do you think the Greens and Solidarity, would like to see in power? They would be...
I would like to see Green policies. I would like to see Solidarity policies. Whether it's Green Party or the Solidarity Party remains to be seen. But I think those parties will play a role in Scotland's future political makeup.
Would you keep the NHS in an independent Scotland?
Oh, not only would we keep the NHS, we would expand the NHS. I never get a chance to make this point in the meeting. Personally, one of the first things we've got to do in an independent Scotland is we've got to get rid of the contradiction where you've got a publicly owned health service but a privately owned pharmaceutical industry. Why are we allowing the privately owned pharmaceutical industry to screw the publicly owned health service left, right and centre? Why are we allowing these people to develop drugs for private profit rather than to cure people? In an independent Scotland, we'll have a publicly owned health service and a publicly owned pharmaceutical industry.
Where do you think would be a good source to get all the money to fund your ideas?
Well, the main source to get the money to fund our ideas is the generation of taxation. Taxation from our companies, taxation from our individuals. You see, if you've got full employment and you're paying people decent wages, then they're paying decent taxes. And if they're paying decent taxes and you're getting the public money from gas, electricity, from oil, people have to buy out the electricity and gas and oil. You know, you can't say to somebody, we're going to have public gas and public electricity, we're not sure if it'll make money. Of course it'll make money, because how else do you live life? You need electricity and gas. You need to be an idiot not to make money from that. That will generate the revenues that will allow us to spend in the health service, in the education, lower class sizes, and make life better for our pensioners.
Why do you think Scotland should have its own currency?
I think Scotland should have its own currency so that we have our own economic plan. You see, if we stay part of sterling, and we may have to for the first couple of years, we stay part of sterling, then the Bank of England can have a say in our economic policy, our interest rates, our money supply. I'm sorry, but sovereignty is sovereignty. Scotland should decide its economic policy. A publicly owned Scottish bank, central bank, with a Scottish currency.
Do you think the polls will discourage some people from voting yes? The polls which show no in front a lot, do you think they'd make people...
Not at all. Every single opinion poll over this last few months, everyone with any credibility whatsoever is showing that there is a movement from undecided to yes. The gap that was there before is now minuscule. It's neck and neck. It's all to play for, and we're going to win.
How important do you think voting is in general?
Voting in general, I think, is very, very important. Obviously, I understand Mark Twain used to make the point, if voting changed anything, they would abolish it, right? I understand that cynical view of voting. The truth is, people fought long and hard, so ordinary working class people got the vote. They give up their lives to fight for the vote. The 1832 Reform Acts, 1918 women's voting. A lot of people fought long and hard to get us the vote. Our problem is our level of political representation has been so poor. I'm afraid it has been lions being led by donkeys as far as the political class is concerned. What we need is some lions to lead the lions. And that's why voting is important, but we need to sort out who it is that's going to represent us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I did this thing the other day about the right to be lazy and that people need time to think. And I'm in Glasgow. The School of Art burned down.
Yeah.
That was bad, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
The School of Art, it was a district. You know you've got 3 people out of the 4 in the Turner Prize this year?
Oh, right.
From Glasgow?
Yeah.
There's a lot of art in Glasgow, isn't there?
Yeah, there's a big art scene. It doesn't have a lot of provision for it. People struggle to get studio space and things like that.
But you've got Glasgow International.
Yeah.
A lot of people have come to Glasgow, gone to art school. They do it around the country, around by Goldsmiths in Camberwell. You can see lots of artists in a little enclave in Peckham. I think Glasgow's got that as well. It's got a massive propensity for music, for novelists, for writers.
Yeah, yeah, it always has, yeah. And also, you've got to remember as well, I mean, culturally...
Yourself.
Culturally, those things are ignored. Do you know what I mean? So there's like, there's not a Scottish programme about writing. Right, so they've got James Kelman, Alistair Gray, all that. You can't imagine a show here that they would make and you would have, you know, Alison Kennedy or any of those people on. You know, the whole thing of the culture is hidden. So it's there, but there's this pretense front of curtain that, you know, we're all a bunch of idiots.
But I think it's also within the UK, it's purposeful because how much music, how many books, how much art is actually made on the Dole.
Yeah, sure, sure. And I mean, a lot of the best stuff.
And because they were given time to think.
But will it still exist? I mean, will you still get those things? I think you'll still get people who are, you'll get more and more people in art who come from middle class backgrounds, which you do anyway. You get more and more people in everything, in comedy. You know, in comedy you have to spend $7,000 or something to do a fringe show every year. So it's self-selecting middle class people, and quality will go down. You know, so I think you'll still have stuff. You'll still have people creating stand-up and books and all that kind of stuff, but it'll get progressively worse.
but the that idea of giving people time or that right to be lazy, they're trying to take away with work fair programs. It's sending people to Asda's, putting a paper hat on.
Yeah, I mean, they've been doing that for a long time. I mean, that's been happening since I was a student, you know. And even student grants going was part of that kind of thing of how do we productivise everything. Do you remember Mandelson when he was Secretary for Business?
Yeah.
Business and Enterprise, was it? And he actually had a thing where he was going to make the universities grade every course in terms of its usefulness to the economy. Mm. You know, and people were saying, well, this is an outrage. You know, great classics and its usefulness to the economy, but he just didn't see knowledge for its own sake as a thing.
But if you take that, what you just said there, Britain, the UK, is one of the leaders in the world in the creatives. Our music, our books, our art, it has a massive, massive return to the chequer. Just take music.
Yeah. Nobody cares about those sort of things in sort of political circles, though. When you meet those people, and I very occasionally met them and stuff like that, they talk about things like entrepreneurship and business and all that kind of stuff. It doesn't matter who they are, the SNP, Labour, Tories.
But they're driving that towards schools, that entrepreneurship, aren't they? They're trying to get that into education.
Yeah. I've been at a thing, a political thing, where people raised the issue of how to get entrepreneurship into primary schools.
Really?
Perhaps, yeah.
Because they do that, they the big pharmaceuticals, because that's what they do. You know, we don't have a state pharmaceutical, you know, it's AstraZeneca and Pfizer. Yeah. These people, they go and sponsor a wing in the university, which is a pittance to them. They take all the ideas, they take everything.
Yeah.
But they do that within the creatives as well. I mean, why do we work? Why do we work? What is work?
I don't know. I mean, it should be something coming from a kind of joy and something you do, shouldn't it? I read the Ragged Trousered Philanthropist as a kid, and I always had that sort of idea of, like, you know, idealist socialism or idealist, I suppose it was idealist communism, where you're saying, you know, everybody should be paid the same, because then people just gravitate towards the things they liked, and you'd have doctors who were really committed to being doctors and artists who were really committed to being artists and so on. But ultimately, I mean, I know it's idealistic, but there is something to that.
But the, you know, well, my thing is when people turn up at the job centre looking for work, give them a fucking guitar.
Right.
You know, everyone wants to be someone.
You know that take that thing, wasn't that something to do with them? There was actually schemes to get people playing more music and stuff. Do you know what I mean? Or was it schemes to help fucking the British record industry?
Oh, what, the Gary Barlow launching all his money?
But there's, I mean, there was...
Was that real? Was there actually a scheme?
Well, certainly, I mean, when I was a student and stuff like that, there were definitely things where, you mean, you say turn up to the Dole Centre and get offered a guitar and stuff, but there were things that people could... get pointed.
They're not interested. They don't want that to happen, because they know that through creativity, through poetry, through music, through comedy, people politicise themselves. You know, people. You know, that's why they don't want squatting. They don't want. You know, they don't want people. The occupy. You know, they don't want people building universities in the fucking street.
Can I just slightly disagree there? I think they don't understand creativity enough to not like it. Do you know what I mean? So the idea of somebody sitting on their own writing poems or something like that doesn't affect anybody in government. They don't care about that. What they don't like is people getting together, right? So that's what they don't like about those things. That's what they don't like about Occupy, is all those people sitting together and going, hey, I agree, you know? That's what they don't like about all those things. If you look at the things that have been hugely stamped down on the last 20 years, you look at things like New Age Travellers and environmental protests and raves and pirate radio, those people all got jail sentences, right? Yeah. If you look at the things that encouraged, things like Twitter, things like being on your own on the internet, things that give the illusion of being with a group of people.
Yeah.
But actually, the fucking Prime Minister's on Twitter. How's that going to be fucking subversive, you know? That should tell you everything you need to know. They're on there themselves. That's how much they support it. Because ultimately, they know that you're in a room on your own and you're not with other people. Everything you do together is a radical act. And that's what they try and stop.
Yeah, they've got other form of punishments as well for the creator, which is sanctioning if you don't go to work. If you don't want to put a paper out on, you're sanctioned.
But remember, Labour didn't vote against workfare.
No, they're for it.
You know.
They started it.
There's a whole thing of, like, the whole kind of intellectual culture of, oh, how do I feel about this morally and all that. And you get a lot of that in the internet as well, where people are like, oh, this is terrible. And, you know, I get pulled up for some jokes, totally innocuous joke about a Tory politician by Stella Creasy, the MP. And so we had a big back and forward about, is this an okay joke? And it was a perfectly simple joke, right? But it clearly had some kind of tripwire for her, right? And I explained why the joke was justifiable. And she was morally outraged for a bit and came round. And the next week, she abstained on the workfare vote. I'd be able to work for no money. You're like, well, where is your moral high ground? I think that's the thing for all of us. We should earn the moral high ground. I don't feel I've got any fucking moral high ground. You know, if you go and work 3 days in a food bank, then you've got a moral high ground to talk about those kind of issues around.
What, like, if you're the government and you say that you haven't that we as a country don't have enough money for the unemployed, or we haven't got enough money for the sick. William Hague has a £2,000 a day stately home in the middle of fucking London. A mansion, yeah. £2,000 a day. Yet we impose, like they say that, you know, this disabled kid, he has to go and sleep in his mum's bedroom.
Yeah. Well, fucking, you know, Cameron's on going, you know, that guy that died from cancer and raised all the money, or, you know, doing some tweet about him and stuff. You think you'll fucking be charging his parents' bedroom tax now, you know?
So who rules the world then? We're going to finish up here. Who rules the world? The Illuminati?
I think large corporations, largely. I think it's been moving that way since probably since the turn of the 20th century. I was reading a book about, there's a good book called The Brothers about John Foster Dulles, who was American Secretary of State. He was kind of pre-Kissinger, prototype Kissinger. And Alan Dulles, who was the head of the CIA, two brothers. And they served under Eisenhower. But they started off in a legal firm that encouraged companies to get together to form corporations, to exert influence. And that's what they were all about. So that was going on since the 1920s, and their family had been doing it before that. So that whole thing of this is how power operates. You get big companies and they expand their markets overseas by using American military might. That's been the story of history for me for the last 100 years.
And I know this week it's been discredited by the Financial Times, his figures, Thomas Piketty's book, Capital. Mm-hmm. But one of the things he was talking about there was, with imperialism going away, that since all the land has been given back, now we've got all the corporations coming back, buying the wheat fields in Mozambique, buying places in Colombia, in Indonesia.
And we're back to Scotland, you know, because that's where they're buying as well, you know, big fucking swathes of it.
Yeah, they said it's the largest concentration of rich land ownership in the world, Scotland.
Yeah.
Isn't that incredible?
Yeah, but it's been going on for a very, very long time, you know, it's been going on for...
But they've been talking about doing some land reforms, I saw it, but they're not moving at all. They're not going to go anywhere, are they?
Yeah, there's a good book about it called The Poor Had No Lawyers.
Yeah.
It explains the sort of genesis of it all.
I'm the Irish taxi driver. This, my friend, has been Frankie Boyle.
Peace.
Frankie Boyle. Well, I'm in Glasgow. So we were just talking about the media and things like that. Now, in England, there's been an election.
Yeah.
Local elections. Now, we've had the rise of UKIP.
Mm-hmm.
They're calling it an earthquake.
Well, it's that whole thing of history repeats itself as tragedy and farce, isn't it? So, like, you know, you've got the Nazis and then you've got these kind of fucking clowns. Do you know what I mean? But they're saying the same fucking thing.
Yeah, England is a little bit racist.
Well, it is, but at the same time, it's made to be racist by policy, you know.
Yeah.
So it's not like there's a groundswell of opinion for racism that and people at the top, you know, they sort of clutch their fan to their chest. Oh, I can't believe this. They want us to be more racist. And the Labour Party had a racist party political broadcast last year. It goes straight through the whole establishment. They've got racist policies. They have racist stop and search policies. They have their racist fans. They have all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And then they go, people seem to be a bit racist. It's a top-down thing for me.
I mean, you're talking about Labour there, but, I mean, they've got this heinous immigration bill that they support. They should never be supporting it. Like, they want to charge people £200 the NHS. They're asking employers, they're asking landlords to ask people for their papers.
But people are, I mean, people are clinging on to some idea of Labour from 50 years ago. Why people would be interested in a party that started an illegal war and killed hundreds of thousands of people? And then be surprised that they've got a racist immigration bill to sponsor. I mean, those wars were by definition racist.
Yeah. I mean, so this rise of the UKIP, but they didn't win a council.
No, and their vote went down. Do you know that?
Yeah. So what is that more media propaganda? Is that incessant every day?
To an extent, it just fits in more with what the media are used to and you're used to reporting. Do you know what I mean? And it makes good copy. I mean, you've got to remember that. That's it makes it. Really good copy. If you've got people so disorganised, they can't fucking, you know, choose a candidate to be a local councillor who doesn't have a collection of Nazi trench knives or whatever it is, right? Then, you know, that's great copy. They're gonna have front page stories for you all year. So, in a sense, I think the media are just subliminally behind it, you know?
Yeah, but they like the idea of the character, like Boris Johnson, yeah. You know.
And they're used to it, because they come from those backgrounds. You know what I mean? So even in The Guardian or something, they all went to school with Boris, you know? So they know those people, and they're familiar with it. The idea of them going out and covering the Green Party, I mean, that to them just looks like a whole load of crystal healers or something. Do you know what I mean? It's but it's how they feel.
But do you think that there's something underlying? Do you think there's something more complicit in it by corporations? Is there an agenda to push everybody to the right, to keep them away from...
I think there's always been an agenda to push everybody to the right since, like, the turn of the 20th century.
Because he's... I mean, in the end, like, if you look at Nigel Farage, that whole story or that whole image, the pint and the smoke...
Yeah.
That's quite... That's a strategy, you know that?
Oh, yeah, I mean, but it's actually quite a kind of basic strategy. Yeah. If you look at, like, UKIP's leaflets and their presentation and stuff like that, they're pretty basic, you know.
But I mean, every single day you get it, like, it's UKIP, they're racist, and their vote keeps going up, so there's something clicking with that, isn't there?
There's something clicking with it, but mostly there's a huge disaffection with politics in general. And you're talking about the 30% of people who vote in local and European elections. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, see, I mean, and looking at that other guy, what's his name?
Ed Miliband. Oh, Ed Miliband, yeah.
He's got a new, is it Axelrod? And the other day, like, he was cracking a smile, which I was saying to you. They don't seem like real people at all, do they? Or...
But why would we be electing these people? Look at Ed Miliband. If we were 500 people, like, abandoned on an island somewhere, who would choose Ed Miliband to lead us? I mean, we would get... You collect fucking kindling or something, mate. You know, you're an oddball. You
don't, you seem incredibly self-conscious and unable to fucking function almost as a human being. You go off and fucking collect shells for us. We create tasks for him to keep him out of the fucking camp.
I think I just realised that I've been skull fucked by calling him David Miliband. That is something that happens quite often, isn't it, on the TV? He was on there and he was saying something like, how much do you get? How much is your food bill a week? Mm. He was like, yeah.
no idea.
No, he went, 70 or 80 pounds.
100 ducats.
Say you. What? So, because the reality is he doesn't pay for his food.
Sure.
None of them do, but
he doesn't even buy it.
No, they don't.
Someone goes and picks up for him.
No, but he actually physically doesn't pay it in cash.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
The public, they pay for it.
Yeah.
It's like free food to those that need it the least. Mm-hmm. And then on the other side, so with all this UKIP shit, there is not one person talking about the Tories. So Cameron, Osborne... Osborne's coming out and he's saying things like, yeah, I think I respect Nigel Farage. You know, without, like, bringing in anything about him being friends with a guy who's friends with Anders Breivik and supports...
To an extent, the Tories feel like sort of like Dracula if people just ignored him. Do you know what I mean? He's just killing people all the time and it's just like, what the fuck do I have to do to get some attention in this village? You know, they just flogged off the fucking Royal Mail to their mates. It announced profits of £670 million, and the BBC headline was, Royal Mail warns that next year's profits may fall. You're like, what, from £670 million to Cameron's mates? All right, that's a strange way of phrasing that story.
They're also, they want to privatise, or they're privatising probation services, privatising child protection.
Well, that would be a disaster.
Well, can you imagine G4S and Serco?
Well, it'll be a disaster. I mean, it's already not working.
But there isn't... you was talking about the other day about creating markets. There isn't even a market there in that. Because the only way that you can make money is cut the services, is cut the wages to the staff.
Well, we were talking about this a little... There's a thing where it's like... They try to create the idea of markets in our heads. So they go, well, the NHS can become a market where we get all these different suppliers competing. And you're like, it's a thing called a monopsony, where you're the one buyer, the state's the one buyer, and you've got all these different buyers, and they're already competing because they're a monopsony, right?
Yeah.
Or you're a monopsony. And what they're trying to do is convert in our heads the idea of that being, oh, it's a market, it's a free-for-all and stuff like that. But, you know, really there's no intellectual basis for that. There's one set of people buying the services, and that's the best position to be in. You know, the NHS is a fantastic thing, and the fact that their share of the vote is still whatever 27%, yeah, the point where they're breaking up the NHS, is that's a propaganda victory. That's incredible propaganda victory.
But the Conservatives still that you know, what do you think about next year's election?
About the general election?
Yeah,
I mean, it could go anywhere, couldn't it? Because you've got. But you've got no sense of choice. So, I mean, Russell Brand thing, for all I think that, you know, you should vote and try and change things if you can. You know, what is your choice? Vote Green. Right, so Green Party have a reasonable set of progressive policies, and they have a reasonable chance of getting some MPs. Outside of that, you've got no choice. I mean, everybody's interchangeable. I mean, your only choice actually is to elect a fucking racist madman into coalition, which that's a possibility. You know, that you'll get some mad right wing.
Well, for the first time, we had a fixed term. And I remember back to 2010, I was outside the gates that day. And it was a couple of days, actually, and I was doing a performance. But there was what are we going to do? We just got the financial crisis, we're fucked. What are we going to do? And that's when the coalition was formed. And I think you might get, in the next election, a Labour-Conservative coalition. Look, we have to hold the country together. It's important.
I don't think you'd ever get that unless it was like a kind of a national crisis type thing. So if you had another financial crash or something in the interim, you might get something like that. But you might get a broader coalition. So you might get something like Tories... UKIP, Liberal.
I don't even know whether the UKIPs, they're saying something like they're going to target 20 or 30 seats, but I can't see.
It'd be interesting to see what the percentage of the vote is, and that won't be reported on. But you know, the percentage of the vote could drop dramatically.
But they will fight the next election on prejudice. You know that it'll be because they fought it so well now. Because it could be a straight fight. It's going to be a straight fight between Cameron and Miliband. I think a lot of UKIP will just go back to the Tories.
I mean, it'll be a race to the bottom. I mean, it'll be a race about prejudice and about ignoring the actual things they've done to transfer public money into private hands, and it'll be possibly the worst choice ever offered to the British people.
Tell the immigrants to go back to their own country, make our clothes, take our toxic waste, and can we have your resources in exchange? We'll be back in 1 second.
What about Home Office or what the policies were?
No one spoke about the Home Office.
Yeah, like, I was really disappointed because I'm someone who supports Scottish independence.
Where do you live?
In a night shelter.
In a night shelter?
Yeah.
So how come do you live in a night shelter?
Well, because, like I said, I'm an asylum seeker.
Yeah.
So my asylum case got refused in November 2011.
Yeah.
And since then, I was asked to provide more evidence to carry on with my case, which I couldn't.
But I just said to you, I'll take you home. You said to me, you can't go there.
Yeah, because the timings for the night shelter, I can only enter it like 8 p.m. in the evening. I have to leave it at 8 in the morning. So the rest of my day, I have to spend on the streets.
From 8 to 8, you're not allowed in there?
Yeah, no.
How long have you been there?
For 2 years. Almost, yeah.
How is that sounds really hard.
It has been extremely challenging, but to be very honest, it has made me a stronger person because there are some amazing people I've met over there. Usually the capacity of the night shelter is like 15 to 20 people.
Who runs the night shelter?
It's a mix of different charities, and together they are called Glasgow Destitution Network. But one of the main charities that is involved, and like I have a huge amount of respect for them, is Unity. Yeah, they provide the maximum number of volunteers over there. There's a Unity Centre office as well here.
So what do you get there? You get a bed?
No, we have to sleep on camper mattresses. It's like a massive hall, and we get provided a camper mattress, a duvet, a sleeping bag. And there are usually 2 to 3 volunteers every night. They cook us a hot meal. And it's been like, when I first got over there, I was diagnosed with OCD, and it was pretty hard for me. And I would go through a major depression, and not to be able to get shower on a regular basis. There are no showers in night shelter. It has been very challenging, but in the same way. Now I'm on the management committee of the night shelter.
Good, no?
Yeah, it's good in a way. I mean, like, the newcomers, whoever they are, I help them to get around the city and helping them how to get around their day, usually what to do.
Was that one of the guys you were with last night?
Yeah. Mohammed, he was supposed to be here. So he's a doctor from Sudan.
Yeah.
And about 2 weeks ago, I think it probably has to do with the Commonwealth Games, they've started stop searching in Glasgow.
Yeah.
So they're randomly stopping people and arresting them on false suspicion. He was walking back to the night shelter, coming back from a meditation conference.
Yeah.
It's a very, 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 like, one of the most beautiful people I have met. Like, so calm, cool. You would never get into trouble with anyone. I've never seen him arguing with anyone. So the way he was describing it is a police car pulled over and they ran towards him and said, "You thief." And he was shocked, and he goes, "Excuse me?" He said, "Let us look at the stolen stuff you're carrying." And he was carrying a bag with, there was only one book inside it. Whatever happened, he tried to phone the coordinator of the night shelter, and they snatched the phone off him. They arrested him. He spent a night in the cell, and then they took him to Dungavel Detention Center for a night, even though his case was still in process. Whatever the reason was, they released him for the next after one day in detention. But it has such a bad effect on him, like he's going through a terrible post-traumatic stress disorder. He won't walk by the same street. He kept going on. They put handcuffs on me. It would have been great if he could have explained it himself.
So who stays in the night shelter?
They're all destitute asylum seekers, like people whose appeal rights have been busted, who have got no recourse to public funds, asylum cases have been refused, and literally they are like stuck in a limbo. They can't go back to their countries because they are in threat of their lives.
Yeah.
And they don't get any money from the government. So night shelter is like was set up to provide support to such people. Itself, night shelter is like, it's a very amazing place. People over there, the volunteers, they're very friendly. They provide you loads of emotional support and help people to get around. But yeah, it's it's one of the most challenging things. Like, I've literally been, from the last 3 years, I've been living with no money. I cannot continue with my education. And how badly it has affected my mental health, only I can understand. Like, I keep telling people that I can empathize with another asylum seeker or a destitute asylum seeker, but unless you have been through the same process and unless you have faced the hostility of the Home Office, once you walk into that office, for me, the day I realized whether I'd really have to question the system is because I put my faith in the system. Like, I was speaking absolute truth what was going on, and I thought they would believe
me. You come from Pakistan.
I come from Pakistan, yeah. I was born in Saudi Arabia, but raised in Pakistan.
And you have a problem with the Taliban?
I had a problem with Taliban. This was in, I came over as a student, and a few months after I was doing my education, I had a very strange relationship with my father. It has been all my life. Like, he waterboarded me when I was 9. He have held me on gunpoints. He's like a tyrant. And this is one another example, I'll come back later on, why I think Scotland should get independent, because you cannot live under tyranny.
Yeah.
And you need independence. Like, you should be able. And since I have become independent, like, it's making me a better person. Like, I know what I'm doing. But yeah, that was a problem. My dad was like, he kept ringing me and asking me to come back, and there are people you could be helpful to. And then I received a number of phone calls from people claiming to be member of Taliban. They were like, you're educated, you're in a blasphemous country, and you shouldn't be there. And I'm like, excuse me, like, I've just been here. And most of it has to do with my past life, because there was a series from the age of 11 to 20. I had to fight my way out of Pakistan, because my dad was the only person paying for stuff. And I had to be very diplomatic with him somehow so he could pay for my education to send me over. And religion is another thing, because, you know, you are forced to agree to something that you're only taught, this is the only way of life, this is the only religion, and you have to follow it. And I myself, I've always questioned things, and it hasn't made sense to me. So,
what's your name? Tony.
Tony, yeah.
So what, I mean, so the night shelter is closed between 8 in the morning and 8 at night.
Yeah.
So what happens in the day? What do you get up to in the day?
Well, today, because it's Sunday, it's the most boring day of the week. There is literally nothing to do. So you have to spend your days out in the streets, or someone who likes going to bookies or just staying watching television.
In the bookies?
Yeah, I mean, like, bookies are open usually, and by 10 o'clock. So,
where,
in the morning.
Bookies, like, where they bet on horses?
Well, you can't bet if you have no money, but yeah, you'll just sit and you'll be watching on television.
Did you go in there?
I do. I have been there a few times, but I mean, the bookies, usually they open 10 o'clock, for 2 hours, literally. There's a shopping mall, St. Enoch's, which opens very earlier. And people who are religious, like, I'm not religious at all whatsoever. Like,
yeah.
I find it really funny to go into church and singing hallelujah. Yeah, usually there's nothing to do. From Monday to Friday, there's the nearest library, Mitchell Library.
Yeah.
That's where people go and they hang out. They can sit on computers, read books if they want. And there are some other charities, like, you can volunteer with. Like, I do theater. I've started doing theater. I've been involved in a theater group and others.
Are you a creative then? You're interested in being creative?
I am, yeah. I've always been interested in arts. Theater is something I think is the best way of expressing yourself.
Yeah.
I could be a very shy person, and it's really hard because being in this situation, you're going through so many mixed emotions, and on days you'll be very happy, and on days you're absolutely upset, you have no idea why you're crying. So theater and being creative, being involved with stuff like that, it really helps you.
You crying?
I have cried, yeah, I've cried a lot. I've lost my mom a few months ago, and that was a very difficult decision for me.
Yeah.
I mean, like, a very difficult thing to come into terms with.
I'm sorry to hear that.
No, well, it's something you know, you have to accept. And there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah.
But things have been very difficult. I'm just the reason I've still been in the shelter for so long is because I couldn't. I just totally don't agree. I think the Home Office is, like, the system of Home Office is totally unjust, absolutely unfair, and I cannot allow someone just to be hostile to me for being honest to them. And I haven't done anything wrong to them. Why would someone be horrible to me?
Have you ever been to the Glasgow UK Border Agency office?
Oh, yeah, many times. I mean, like, they've just been questioning, and they could see that I'm upset, I'm broken, that I couldn't even talk. Because, you know, there's stuff that's been happening. They're asking me, so why would your father do that to you? And I'm like, well, I don't know, and I don't care. Like, I keep asking myself, but that's why I'm telling you. Like, I'm sharing a secret with you that I have a genuine problem. And now, another thing is, I'm telling you that I don't believe in religion. That the statement itself would get me killed in Pakistan.
Yeah.
And I mean, like, I can't even say it will put me in danger over here.
But do you know, I saw a picture of the Glasgow UK Border Agency and it had a big poster and it said, go home.
Yeah.
And it put go home on the back of the chairs.
Yeah, see, when that campaign was going on, someone found out, I read somewhere, that there was a youngest MP or someone who was working with the Home Office. She resigned because she found out that they have this hostile environment department within the Home Office.
The what?
Hostile environment department.
What do they do?
So they are actually immigration officers, they are trained to be hostile towards people, to immigrants, asylum seekers.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, like, this is all over news, you can read about it.
Yeah?
They were given gift vouchers for wrapping up cases, 70% of cases, numbers, and Home Office is not there to listen to people's cases, it's to restrict immigration. And there are so many people, like, you're talking about rape victims, torture victims, people have been tortured, and people, war-affected countries, when that guy was going on about labor, labor this, labor that, and I'm like, so, are you disagreeing that labor are war criminals? Like,
I see in the UK Border Agency, in a picture, I saw the go home, and hanging from the ceiling was a big aeroplane.
So when people
there was an aeroplane which said go home on it.
Yeah, it was, in fact, they had stickers of footsteps towards the desk, like, is signing on too difficult? Is going home easy? So, yeah, the footsteps would take you towards this desk where you can sign a voluntary return, assist a voluntary return form. And but I think they have, I don't know if they have changed that scrap.
What's
that
your campaign. Thought? Because there's been the UKIP is rising. They're saying that, like, you know, the move to the right. You know, there's a lot of politics of prejudice, isn't there?
Well, it's very obvious. I mean, like, pro-immigration people are. In general, Scotland needs people. Like, you know, Scotland has got, there's only one detention center in Scotland. I support independence for sure. Like, I'm not saying that SNP is right. I would never support a center-right party anyways. Like, I mean, that's totally unjust. But there shouldn't be detention centers. I'm anti-nuclear weapons. Like, you don't need scrap trident. You'll be saving shitloads of money. And if that's what they're worried about, a scrap trident, you'll get 100 billion right there.
People need, Glasgow, Scotland needs people like Tony.
Well, like I said, I was born in Saudi, raised in Pakistan, but by heart I'm Scottish, and I'll always be.
First of all, I'd like to ask you a couple of questions. What do you think about the Home Office and their treatment of you?
I think Home Office is like, the system of Home Office, they are totally unjust, unfair, and they are completely violating human rights. It's not just treatment of me, but all the asylum seekers, the way they have been treated, and people I have met, is just absolutely unbelievable. It's like someone comes to my house, and the way I see things and I perceive things, someone comes to my house, I'll offer them a cup of tea and ask them if they want to eat, I'll offer them my bed. It's just so unbelievable. How can someone be so horrible to you and for no reason, just because you're telling them that your country is not safe to live in, and you're sharing your truth, you're telling them the truth. And it's just unbelievable. Like, I mean, I cannot describe it in words. It's just absolutely ridiculous.
What do you think about the UK's government decision to refuse Syrian refugees to enter the country?
Well, again, I mean, they should take an example from what Sweden have done. Just given everyone indefinite status. And they have done it in the past. I mean, it's been a group of people. They allowed Libyan refugees, and all of a sudden, they started refusing all the Libyan cases. And before that, there were the Egyptian guys. I mean, they should take Sweden as an example, which is part of the European Union. And Britain claims to be part of the European Union. They should, I mean, they deserve, they are struggling, and they deserve a very, very fair chance.
Do you think Scottish independence would help asylum seekers?
Yeah, I love that question. Well, I support independence, and again, I've said it in the past on many occasions to different people, and the reason I support independence is, before we get to immigration or anything else, I was raised under a tyrant household, and unless you're independent, unless you're given the opportunity to make your own decisions, unless you're independent, there is no way the country can progress, and there is no way you can progress under tyranny. For asylum seekers, I believe Scotland in general is a very, very welcoming nation. They love people. Like, I feel being here, like I'm around people who actually love me, and they don't judge me for who I am, or they don't say that I'm lying because I have different color. In general, I mean, Scotland needs people, and there is so much people would happily contribute. Like, I have spoken to loads of asylum seekers. Like, I move around the same community. There are people who generally want to contribute. I'm saying it just now, right? If Scotland gets independence, I do not want to live in England or Wales. I cannot live in England or Wales. I want to be here in Scotland. And just, I love it so much. Like, it's just unbelievable. Scotland, I think it would be great for asylum seekers if Scotland gets independence.
What steps should the UK take to help people like you?
Well, they don't want to help people like me, or else they won't let people like me in the situation that I have been or my other fellow asylum seekers have been. It's very obvious that they want to restrict immigration, and they want to blame asylum seekers and immigrants for homelessness, for jobless, and joblessness. Like, asylum seekers are taking our jobs, they're taking our money. You're not even allowed to work. Like,
so how could they help the situation? How could they make it better? How could they improve it? How could they improve life for you in the UK?
Well, I mean, the way what my experience have been so far is, like, they have been so ignorant and so hostile that I've never felt welcomed at all through the eyes of Home Office. Well, if they would allow asylum seekers to work, they can contribute to the taxes. Like, there was a debate previously where your dad was campaigning and doing the debate. Over there, they were talking about taxpayer money spent on the white paper, like that guy from Labour, John, whatever his name is. Well, excuse me, you spent £180,000 just to remove one guy from the country, and he was on a hunger strike for 100 days. £180,000 of taxpayers' money was spent on his removal. So if you allow these people to work, they can contribute, they will pay taxes, and I mean, that would be a huge help. If asylum seekers are allowed to study, first of all, if they're allowed to work, people can work, they'll be able to pay rents, they'll be able to afford their own houses, and that would be a huge help. Like, education would be a huge help. There's so much that needs to be done, and UK government can do.
What are your views on freedom of movement? Do you think there should be certain restrictions, or should people just be able to migrate?
We are human beings. I mean, the concept of having borders is ridiculous. Every human being should be allowed to move and to go and travel freely wherever they want. Like, I was raised in Pakistan. I was given Pakistani nationality. Now, that is an imprisonment itself, because you cannot move freely to even your neighborhood countries. You need to ask permission. Anyone, like, not just people within Europe, or you shouldn't be asking to get a British passport so you can travel around the country freely. No, I mean, like, there should be freedom of movement. People should be allowed. I suppose Scottish independence, but for independence, I don't mean borders. I mean an independent government who can take their own decisions. But yes, people should be allowed to move freely. They should be allowed to work wherever they want. The wealth of the entire world should be shared equally. The world would be such a better place.
So what do you think about UKIP's stance on immigration?
Racists. I mean, I it's totally worthless to talk about UKIP. I mean, I'm not even going to go there.
Okay, do you have any views on the use of drone strikes in Pakistan?
Yeah, I mean, the Pakistan government has been as corrupt as... they've been working with alliance with the US government. And drone strikes, some of the activists have kept on bringing it up and saying it's challenging the country's sovereignty. You are just going about, and it's whenever there have been drone strikes, innocent people have died. And it's not just people, they've been animals in the same places. Like, you're killing animals, you're killing people, and with no evidence whatsoever, then why are you carrying them out? It's drone strikes have been like one of the biggest, and Pakistan government have been allowing drone strikes because they want the drone technology from the US government.
Would you ever like to go back to Pakistan, or would you prefer to stay in Scotland?
I cannot live in Pakistan. I mean, Pakistan is such a, in such a bad state. For me to hope for Pakistan to be a better country, I'm talking about 2,000 years, and I won't be able to live till that long. Pakistan needs to change in so many different ways. It has to be secular. There should be freedom of religion, freedom of speech. There should be no blasphemy laws. All these things needs to be changed, and it's not a safe country for someone like me to live, because, you know, as soon as I land in Pakistan, someone will kill me. Like, I tell my childhood friend that I'm confused about God, and he'll be like, well, you're blasphemous, and it's obligatory for me to kill you.
Do you feel more Scottish now, or still do you feel a strong connection to Pakistan?
I have changed a lot, and the reason I have become a total independent, different person is because I had a chance to see things for myself and experience them on my own. I think I'll just go back to what my friend says, that I don't look Pakistani by looks and by thoughts. Like, I'm totally, I don't agree with whatever people in Pakistan in general agree, whether it has to do with women rights or, again, religion for other reasons, or equality for everyone, secularism, left. I mean, people are, I'm very, very, I think, very, very Scottish, I would say.
Okay.
My heart.
Okay, thank you for this interview.